I think we still have a few minutes to go, don't we? Woohoo! All right.
I will enter his gates with thanksgiving in my heart. I will enter his courts with praise.
I will say,
this is the day
that the Lord has made.
I will rejoice,
for he has made me glad.
He has made me glad. I will rejoice, for he has made me glad.
This morning, when I was driving about 8 o'clock this morning, setting out the signs at the end of Fisk Road here and out at the corner of the county road, one of the things that struck me was the morning sunlight hitting some of the trees and bushes that were glistening with some frost on them. And I thought, how awesome is God to create such beauty in nature? Paul tells us in Romans chapter 1 that we can see God's eternal qualities and what's been made. Hey, His eternal nature is there in creation for us to see. And so this morning I was thinking, how awesome is God to give us such beauty in nature? Yes, it's true. Sometimes there is destruction in nature too. But God's eternal qualities are visible if we look for them. You know, we have to be willing to look for them and able to see them and then be able to just recognize that it's God's handiwork. A few nights ago, I can't remember which night it was, there was a sunset that was absolutely stunning. I don't know if that was Monday night. The sunset was absolutely stunning. Beams of light coming straight up, you know, out of the setting sun. It was just incredible. And I thought, boy, one of these days, that's what it's going to look like when Jesus comes back. Just light beaming everywhere. And it's going to be an awesome day. And I'm looking forward to that day. But in the meantime, we got life to live down here, don't we? Hey? We got stuff to go through. And I mean, by the way, I mean stuff is, yeah, some of it's kind of difficult. Others are a little bit burdensome. And but you know what? In it all and through it all, God is faithful. He is always faithful. And the song I want to start off with this morning, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand has provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. I see a big crew coming in the door. Let's just wait a minute to let them get in and settle down. And then we'll start singing. God's faithfulness is truly, truly great. He is faithful to His word, always. To His promises, always. And God's faithfulness proves true. Even when we are not faithful. Hey? It's true. It's true. When we're not faithful, God still remains faithful. He cannot be other than He is a faithful God. And so we praise Him for that. We thank Him for His goodness to us. I'm going to invite you to stand, if you're able, to join us in this song and sing and worship with us as we sing together.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, the compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, Thy hand hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to Thy great faithfulness, mercy.
Just a minute. As we're singing that verse, oh, can you go back to that verse?
Absolutely.
Whoa. There's a great book I finished reading. It's called I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist. And in that book, the two scientists talk about all of the evidence there is for creation, for design behind creation. And when we were singing this, I was thinking about the sun, the moon, the stars. Did you know there are at least 120 anthropic principles? An anthropic principle is a principle that has to be holding true for us to exist on this planet in this space and time. 120 of them lining up perfectly. The distance from the sun, the closeness of the moon. We're on a knife edge of probability of like 37 zeros and a one. And that just happened by chance. No, it didn't. It was design. It was design. God put us here, and He put us here for a purpose, and He loves you, and He wants you to know His faithfulness. So let's sing the chorus of that. Now, great is thy... Let's go into the chorus.
Great is thy faithfulness. Great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
Faithful God, you are the eternal God. You exist beyond time, and therefore your strength does not diminish. Your character does not change. Oh, Father, we just sang strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. God, when I look at society today, it seems like we're losing hope. More and more people are losing hope because they do not have anything beyond themselves to hang on to reach toward. But we reach toward you, oh God. We reach toward you in faith. And we trust you, God. We trust in your goodness and your faithfulness. Even when, and especially when, the circumstances would say, nope. Oh, we say yes. Because we believe your word. Because we believe what we have experienced in the past. We believe what others have said and testified to. All of the evidence coming together to say, God, you are trustworthy. You are faithful. We can place our hope and trust in you. And we praise you this morning. Receive the worship we have to bring today. Just as a thank offering, as a gift to you from our hearts, from our souls, from our minds. Praise you, Lord. We praise you. If you're able to stay standing, do so, please, as we sing this song. Here I am to worship. You know, God alone is worthy of our worship. And let's sing this song together, please.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Wonderful to me. King of all days, oh so highly exalted, glorious in heaven above. Humbly you came to the earth you created, all for love's sake became poor. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. And I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. I'll never know how much it costs to see my sin upon that cross. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me. So here I am to worship, here I am to bow down, here I am to say that you're my God. You're altogether lovely, altogether worthy, altogether wonderful to me.
Praise God, praise God. You may be seated, please. Oh, my heart is full today. It really, truly is. I really feel full today. And I was thinking about this, here I am to worship. And you've heard me say before, you know what? We're designed to have a master. We're designed for worship. And one way or the other, you worship somebody or something. Doesn't matter. Oh, no, I don't worship God. You know what I found really interesting, and I asked an evolutionist this one time, because they were adamant that, you know, as a Christian minister, I was, you know, way off course. I said, can you help me understand something? In your theory of evolution, how come every civilization we have ever discovered, whether ancient or fairly recent, they've always had some form of worship beyond themselves? How do you fit that into evolution? You can't. There's no place for that in evolution. It doesn't fit. And yet the truth is that every single civilization, no matter how far back you go, has had some form of worship beyond itself. And I say that's proof that there is a principle inside of us of a desire to connect to our Creator. A desire to connect with the God who made us. And that gives meaning and purpose to life. Friends, there is great meaning and purpose when we realize that God has so desired a relationship with us that he sent his one and only son to die for us. That broken relationship could now be restored and renewed, and we can take hold of that by faith in Jesus Christ. There is an old song that's been updated a little bit. I like the old one. I like the updated one. You know what? I don't have preferences one way or the other. As long as their song speaks truth, I don't mind singing it. And I want to be part of singing that. So this song, Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. All right. So let's try this. It's been a while since I sung this. So you're going to have to help me on this because I want to get the right cadence.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see.
'Twas grace.
'Twas grace that taught my heart to feel. fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me.
Such an awesome hope in Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Well, today's the Sunday we do things a little differently. And that is to give Melanie and the kids in Children's Church a little bit more time because Melanie felt like she wasn't getting through everything she wanted to get through. And I told her I could just preach longer. She said, no, let us out earlier. That'll be better. Missed my opportunity. Oh, well. So, you kids, you're going to go off to Children's Church. And so let me just pray with you before you and Melanie head downstairs. Father, thank you for the kids. Thank you that you love them so much. And Jesus, that you are the one who called them to yourself. And you put your hands on them and blessed them. And you told us, adults, us big people, that unless we become like little children, we'll never enter the kingdom of God. Wow. That's pretty awesome. So God, as the little kids go downstairs, help us big kids to be able to really get what you want us to get this morning, and we can become who you want us to become. Thank you, Jesus. Bless them. Amen. All right. Will you go downstairs? I think we're good. Right. Woohoo.
My daughter just said, "You coming, Dad?"
You coming, Dad? Well, you're one of the big kids, eh? Okay. All right. Oh, yeah. I'm going to get to that, Jay. Just a second. So we welcome you to worship. Number of friends of ours from Pembroke are down here joining us in the service today. They're kind of helping us celebrate. Helping us celebrate Jason's birthday, which was this past Wednesday. And we appreciate their friendship and their love and support. I want to mention for Jason, just he's asked for prayer. He slipped and fell this week. I think it was Thursday, really wrenched his back. He's been in excruciating pain this week. And so just pray for him that God will minister to him. What's that? No, that's okay. That's okay. We'll take some time. Also, mercy on her life and just the way God just keeps answering prayer. Crystal.
I was going to have you do this, Pastor. I just wanted to explain a little bit about the prayer mat. If people.
Oh, yes. No, certainly. Why don't we? I'm going to try and give you the mic here so that people can hear this, okay?
I won't preach on you, brother.
Okay. You know what? If God tells you to, you better.
Amen.
Okay. I just wanted to tell you people that as a church body, wow, get a big praise God. But I just want to let people know, if you want to be part of the prayer net, as you call me, and like I tell people over and over, and I pray this, Lord, I'm not above anybody else, but if you would call me, and if you have a prayer request, please let me know. And there's a few that have signed up to be part of the prayer team. But if you want to be part of the prayer team, like Wayne, and Cindy, anybody else have a conviction?
No pressure here.
No pressure.
No pressure here. Anyone that wants to be part of the prayer team, please call me and I'll explain the gamut. Because sure. We need prayer. God said, my house shall be called a house of prayer.
Amen. 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 Amen.
Yeah. So the prayer net is, if you sign up and volunteer to be part of that, you will receive the prayer requests that come in to Crystal. She'll call you and let you know. I want you to be clear on this, okay? When you give a prayer concern to Crystal, she will write down exactly what you want communicated, and that is all that will be communicated. Because in the past, we've had sometimes, maybe not in this church, but I know of other churches where the thing just kind of goes on and then gets added to. And by the time Gladys is getting prayed for, she's in the hospital with two broken legs, two broken arms, and whatever else. When all she had was a boil on her, on her side. But you just, let's, you know, we're very specific in how we communicate these things. So you need to know that you can trust this not to be kind of what could be otherwise called a gossip line, okay? So we just want to be sure you know that. Brother Tim.
I'm grateful that the Holy Spirit can read my heart.
Yes.
The unintelligible grumblings that come out of my mouth, the Holy Spirit knows what they really mean.
Yes, He does. Praise God. That's for sure. That's for sure. Praise the Lord. Yeah, we can take them to Him directly, absolutely. And sometimes it's wonderful to have the rest of the body grown with us, shall we say. Hey, praise God. I've been kind of struggling a little bit. I'm just going to take a moment here to just kind of unpack something to you before we... Sharon, you're next after this. You're going to say, and I have the words up here. I have the words for you up here. Okay. I want to just mention something about truth. Okay. Is something true just because I say it is?
No.
Now, you would hope that I wouldn't lie to you. And based on a relationship of trust and the position of trust that God has... anointed me for, that I would speak truth to you every time. But just because I say it is true doesn't mean it is true. It doesn't make it true. So what has to happen for us to know that something is true?
Research.
Scripture.
Discernment.
Okay. Evidence. Hey, proof. Reason. Is it reasonable? If it fails the reasonable test, you kind of go, oh, wait a minute, maybe I need to look at this a little more, right? If something is not true just because I say it is, what if through argument and persuasion I can convince every one of you in the room that it is true? Does that make it true? Okay. What if I could convince everyone living in Ontario that something is true, even if it can't be backed up through science or medicine? Does that make it true?
No.
Okay, bear with me. What if I could convince half the world that something is true, even if it can't be backed up through science, medicine, or any other kind of proof? Does that make it true? No. So, here's my point. If I say I am gay because I'm born that way, does it make it true?
No.
All right? I want you to understand this, because this is the argument that is being used across the world to say, to prove something that there is no proof for. I would need to be able to point to scientific and or medical clinical studies to back up what I claim as truth. Okay? I want to tell you right now, there are no medical or scientific or sociological studies to prove that someone is biologically gay, born that way. There's claim to it all over. There is no study, one way or the other, to prove yes or no. And yet the claim is made. If I say I'm gay and I cannot change, does that make it true?
No.
No. It's a claim. Where's the proof? You would need to point to the clinical studies that definitely show the results of years of research to say this is true. I will say that in 1970, psychiatrists voted to remove homosexuality off the list of treatable disorders. So no attempts have been made, no clinical studies compiled, one way or the other, to demonstrate it is proof, beyond any reason, reasonable doubt, to say it's true one way or the other. One of the things that concerns me about the new reality that people are claiming is that they claim, I'm born this way, I cannot change, and you do great harm if you try to suggest I should change. You know what? Those are truth claims that have no backing whatsoever in medical, scientific, clinical, psychological research. Amen. There isn't. What we do have as Christians is proof from God's word that those who have chosen a gay lifestyle, and I will say lifestyle, it's a choice, okay, can change. In 1 Corinthians 6, verses 9 to 11, we hear Paul say this, "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived." Did you hear that first part? Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate. You know what effeminate is? Guys who think they are women and dress that way. Okay? Nor homosexuals, those who are either men with men or women with women. Nor thieves, nor the covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. Listen carefully. His next words. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 11. Such were some of you. Did you catch that? Were. But you were washed. But you were sanctified. But you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and the Spirit of your God. Not everyone will inherit the kingdom of God. Not everyone will be able to enter heaven, but praise God, there is hope and healing and freedom in Jesus Christ, no matter who it is. Right. Understand, no matter who it is. And we will continue to stand on that truth. And if I need to be shown that I am not speaking truth right now, show me. Talk to me. But I want this to be clear. And why do I talk about this on a Sunday morning in church? Because everybody around you is talking about this the six other days of the week and trying to force you to think that this is truth and there is no other way to think about it or to look at it. And I want you to understand there is another way to look at it, and we look at it through the lens of the Scriptures, which we accept as truth. So let's keep holding to truth, always, listen, speaking the truth in love. Always. Always speaking the truth in love. We don't have a right to say hateful things, act in hateful ways to anybody. We don't. And I'll be the first one to call you out if you do. I'll tell you, stop it. We treat everyone with love and respect. We do. Praise God.
Pastor?
Yes.
Well, in addition to that, is that there are literally thousands around the world who have been delivered
yes.
by Christ from that
yes.
Slavery. And that community, LGBTQ,
the alphabet
community are doing everything in their power to try to shut these
shut that down
because they do not want to hear the truth.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Can I just add one thing?
Certainly.
Goes on. If you don't agree and you challenge somebody, you're called racist.
You're racist or hateful.
And it has nothing to do with race.
No.
Exactly. No. There's only one race.
Yeah, the human race. Yeah. No, no, but yeah, if we challenge somebody's accepted truth, then we're called hateful or discriminatory or whatever else. But you know what? As somebody said to me, we discriminate all the time. I discriminated this morning for breakfast. I discriminated against my oatmeal and ate my bran flakes.
If I remember correctly, you got an awful hate on for pickles, mister.
I have a hate on for pickles. Yes, I do. That's true. I discriminate against pickles. Discrimination is a matter of choice. What do I choose? Who am I, and how do I move forward in that? And I'll tell you, folks, it is always on the basis of truth. And let's be careful about what we're allowing the world to push into our brains as truth without looking at it objectively and saying, where do we put this? How do I look at this? And then moving forward in love so that we can still be able to declare the truth of Jesus Christ. Sharon, would you? Yes, Miriam.
Can I just read part of Romans chapter 1 here?
Yeah, you can read part of Romans chapter 1. I need you to have the microphone, though.
Okay.
All right.
I'll start at verse 24. Am I on? Am I being done?
Yes, okay.
Okay, here we go. Romans chapter 1, starting at verse 24. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lusts of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Verse 26, for this cause God gave them up unto vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature. Verse 27, and likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error, which was meet, or which means due. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. However, we do have Jesus Christ that we can go to repent, and he will cleanse us from all sin.
That's right. Amen. Amen. Sharon, would you... I'm glad you ended on that note too, because that really helps us hear what God's laid on Sharon's heart to share with us in song.
A few weeks ago, maybe a week and a half ago, I just overheard Pastor Herb saying that he would soon be starting Easter messages. So I hope you don't think that this piece is too pre-Easter, but it is the real story of Easter, how the Savior went to the cross.
Facing for sin. Yes.
As he walked, as he was strapped and whipped and beaten, yeah, and cursed on and whatever, he was praying for us.
Praise God.
I had a devotional, just a quick one, Pastor.
Absolutely.
This morning from my devotional book, this December, Deuteronomy 31:8. It's March. And the Lord, he is the one who goes before you. He will be with you.
Just a minute. Try that.
Deuteronomy 31:8. And the Lord is the one who goes before you. He will be with you. He will not leave you nor forsake you. Do not fear nor be
afraid.
Praise God.
Off again. Thank you. Sorry about that. There's something wrong with the cord on this mic. I think we're going to have to replace that. All right. Those of you who weren't here last week, I didn't get to preach my sermon, my third and final on generosity. God just kind of took over the service, and it was pretty awesome. It was, and I use that word sparingly, the word awesome. I only use it in reference with God. And I'll tell you what, it was an amazing time, and God really did minister in a powerful, powerful way. So you're getting the third and final installment and a bit of a delay on my series leading up to Easter, which is fast approaching. And we'll get there. We'll get there. If you like having the sermon notes section to fill in the blanks, there a number of you got them last week. Hopefully you still have it around. If not, there might, I don't know if there's still one or two sitting on the back rail there. I don't think so. They may be all gone. But anyway, fill in the blanks will come up on the screen and you'll be able to do that. So Giving Living, part three. The story goes that while Robert Smith was taking his afternoon walk, part of his therapy from recovering from a massive heart attack, the home phone rang and his wife, Dolores, answered it. The call was from the publisher's clearinghouse, informing her that her husband, Robert, had just won, get this, $500,000. The check, they said, those great big, you know, cardboard or plastic checks would be presented with TV cameras and news crew in a few days. Well, as you can imagine, Dolores was absolutely ecstatic. Now all those things they had dreamed of doing were about to happen. But then she remembered that her husband was just getting over his heart attack and the doctor had insisted no excitement over anything. Keep his pulse down were his specific instructions. Well, Dolores was afraid that if she told him he had just won a large sum of money, he would have another heart attack and possibly die. What could she do? And after trying to come up with a solution, she decided to call the pastor and ask his advice because, she reasoned, that he had considerable experience in dealing with challenging situations. Dolores dialed. Hello, Pastor Baldwin. This is Dolores Smith. Oh, hi, Dolores. How are you? And how is Bob doing? Oh, fine. He's fine. We're both doing well. Bob is recovering nicely, but I've got a problem and I really need your help. Sure, I'd be glad to. What seems to be the problem? Well, I just got a phone call from the house home sweepstakes people that Bob has won $500,000. Oh, Dolores, that's wonderful, the pastor chimed. I'm so happy for you both. You really are reaping what you've sown for so many years. But Dolores, I don't understand what seems to be the problem. Well, Pastor, I'm afraid that if I don't find just the right way to tell Bob, the shock will be too much and he'll have another heart attack and I'll lose him. Can you help me? Oh, Dolores, I'd be happy to. Leave it to me. Put on the tea and I'll be right over. And 20 minutes later, Bob, Dolores, and Pastor were chatting over a cup of tea when the pastor leaned forward in his chair and said, Bob, I've got a problem. I need your advice. Sure, Pastor, I'd be glad to help, if I can. Well, now it's only a theoretical, hypothetical situation regarding stewardship. What would a person do? Well, take yourself, for example. What would you do if all of a sudden you found out that you had won $500,000? What would you do with all that money? Oh, that's easy, Bob quickly replied. I'd start by giving it half of it to the church, whereupon the pastor had a massive heart attack and died. This morning we're in our third and final on the series of generosity. And we've defined generosity as the act of giving without expecting anything in return. If we expect something in return, that's trading, right? That's not generosity. This morning I want us to take a look at generosity through what Paul wrote in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, starting at verse 6. Let me read that passage. The verses will come up on the screen for you there. Now I say this, the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and the one who sows generously will also reap generously. Each one must do as he has decided in his heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace overflow to you so that always having all sufficiency in everything, you may have an abundance for every good deed. As it is written, he scattered abroad, he gave to the poor, his righteousness endures forever. Now, he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness. You will be enriched in everything for all liberality, that word is generosity as well, which through us is producing thanksgiving to God. I want us to mine this passage like a gold mine for some generosity principles that can help us develop a lifestyle of generous living if we aren't there already. And maybe some of these gold nuggets that we find in this passage will help spur you on even further in the life that God is already showing you how to live. So let's dig down and let's see what kind of gold nuggets we can find. In verse 6, true generosity always gets a return. Generosity never makes you a loser. Verse 6, what does it say there? The one who sows generously will also reap generously. Now, sowing seed in Paul's day is different than our day. Nowadays, you have a big old tractor. You have a big old seed drill. That's literally what it's called, a seed drill, towed behind the tractor with air and all this stuff. And a blast of air goes in, puts a little hole in the ground, shoves the seed in, covers it with soil again, puts fertilizer around it. Every seed is drilled into the soil. Back in Paul's day, sowing seed meant scattering it by hand, right? Now, question for you. Was the sower guaranteed that every seed would produce a harvest? No. So what would happen to some of the seed?
Get eaten by birds.
What else? Hey? Squirrels. Okay, let's just put animals in general.
Fall on hard ground.
Hard ground. On rocks. Remember the parable of Jesus you talked about. Weeds grow up, choke it out, right? Only some falls on good ground and produces a harvest, not every seed. So, will every act of generosity see a return? No, not necessarily. Some people will take what you give and not even say thanks. Ever had that happen? I have. Some people may say thanks, but never think about helping you in return if you ever needed help. Still others will misuse or abuse your generosity, try to take advantage of it. But the principle is still there. Generosity always gets a return on its investment. If for some reason you've been burned trying to be generous and have pulled back from being as generous as you once were, I would suggest that two negatives are happening. Number one, the enemy of your soul is winning a major victory in your life. You see, God's purpose is to conform you into the image of His Son. That's what He wants for you. As a believer in Jesus Christ, God's purpose is to form you inside into the image of His Son. And Jesus Christ was and is the perfect image of giving, living. And people took advantage of him, misunderstood him, were ungrateful, even to the point of killing him. But to pull back means that God cannot continue his work of conforming you into the image of his Son. And Satan wins a victory. But number two, the negative, if you've pulled back from being as generous as you once were, a second negative is taking place. You are not reaping or harvesting as much as God wants you to be able to access for your life. You see, God wants you to have access to more. And we'll get to why he wants that. All right? And if you've pulled back from generosity, guess what? You can't access all that God wants for you, and you start losing out. Jesus put it this way in Luke chapter 6, verse 38. Give, and it will be given to you. They will pour into your lap a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. For by your standard of measure, it will be measured to you in return. Wow. Leave that verse up there for a moment, if you would. I'm sorry if you've heard this before, I'm repeating myself, but every time I read this verse, I think of when I was a little kid and Mom asked me to take the brown sugar from the little plastic bag and put it in the container. Well, I wanted to find out how much brown sugar I could shove into that container. And I'll tell you what, I got the whole bag into that container. Man, I pushed that down. I was never allowed to put the brown sugar in that container again. Because it was packed so hard, Mom couldn't get it out. She'd jab it with a knife and stuff. But I'm reminded, that's what God says he wants. He wants to like press down, shaken together, get it, and then overflowing. That's what God wants. That's what God wants for you. But when we pull back, we can't experience that. And that really leads us to this next gold nugget, which is number two. True generosity always gets a return, but it is proportional and conditional. I don't know if you ever thought of it that way before. True generosity is proportional. The return is proportional and conditional. Verse 6, the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. I mean, that's true. If a farmer goes and, you know, spreading seed by hand in a great big field, oh, I'm getting tired of this. I'm just going to go home and put my feet up and, do something. What kind of harvest are they going to get? They're only going to get in proportion to what they sowed. And not all of that is going to reap a return, because as we already said, the one who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. And the one who sows generously will also reap generously. Also, Paul says in Galatians 6, verse 9, let us not become discouraged in doing good. For in due time, we will reap if we do not become weary. True generosity is proportional. And here Paul tells us it is also conditional. In due time, we will reap. What's the next word? Yes. If, there's the condition, we do not become weary. I don't know about you, but sometimes you keep giving and giving and giving and giving. You think, really? Oh. But if you've been burned, don't give up. Don't give up. Don't let the devil win. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus comes to give life, and that more abundantly. Amen. Jesus isn't the one trying to take away stuff from you. Satan is. So if you've been burned, if you've pulled back, instead of striking out on your own and trying generosity again, why not ask God how he wants you to do it? And to whom? When and where? Does that sound too simple? I hope so, because you know what? Unless you become as little children, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Simple. God, I feel like I've pulled back. I feel like I've been burned here. Show me. Show me what I can do. Show me to whom you want me to extend the generosity. By how much, when, where. And then by faith, wait to see what God might do. It might come all of a sudden, boom, right in the middle of a circumstance or situation. I watched this happen the other day. Somebody was trying their card and it wouldn't work, and it wouldn't work at the grocery store. And they were embarrassed. And they said, well, I'll just run out to my car and get... And I thought... I wasn't the next one in line. I was behind that. And I thought, they're going to run out to the car and drive away because they're just embarrassed by the whole situation. And I felt something coming up and said, do something. And the person in front of me said, here, use my card. I thought, yes, that's great. And of course, the perfunctory, oh, no. Just use my card. It's okay. I thought, thank you, God. There's just a cool picture. Who knows, but God might have that situation. Other times, God might start to build something in your mind about somebody that you're supposed to go and see or talk to or anonymously even drop off a gift, whether it's money or a meal or something else, and just let it happen that way. But ask Him. Ask Him to direct you to the person or situation He wants you to move toward. Ask Him for the faith and trust you need to practice true generosity again. So, let's see what else we can learn about true generosity through this passage in 2 Corinthians 9. Verse 7, first part. True generosity comes from a freed heart. True generosity comes from a freed heart. Each one must do just as they have decided in their heart, not reluctantly or under compulsion. At first, I was going to use the words a willing heart, but I believe a freed heart says it better. See, true generosity comes from a heart that's freed from the disease of desire. Amen. The curse of comparison. Or the grasp of greed. Amen.
Or the lack of trust in God.
Or the lack of trust in God. It's true. You see, reluctance or compulsion can come from any one of these, or can come from a heart that doubts our Heavenly Father's true love and care. That doubts His power and ability to provide. A heart that fears that God won't come through on what He promises. See, true generosity comes from a freed heart. But what if you've never had true generosity modeled for you? Or what if the hurts and disappointments have shut that down in your life? Then listen carefully. Please listen to me carefully. Reluctance or compulsion is not the best place to start. But it's also not the worst place to start or restart learning the joy of generosity. The best place to start would be to pray and ask God to fill you with His love and His joy, to show you what needs to be confessed or repented of in your backing away from generosity and shutting down, so that you can be filled with His perfect love, washed by the blood of the Lamb. And whatever is that needs to be crucified can die with Christ. But if you have to start at the place of forcing yourself to be generous while gritting your teeth, it's not the worst way to start developing the habit of generosity. It's a little like making a decision to, what? Start living more healthy lifestyle. Okay? At first, you start doing things because you have to. Not because you want to or because you feel better doing it. It's kind of like when I found out I had diabetes the last, 4 years or so. Oh, you got diabetes. I'm going to send you to the nutritionist. I go to the nutritionist. And she starts telling me all the stuff I can't eat. Okay? And I said to her, so basically you're telling me that I can eat tofu and cardboard. That's what's left. And she goes, pretty much. Okay, thank you. So now there's a whole whack of stuff I'm not allowed to eat. Do I like it? No. Do I like yams and sweet potato? No, not particularly. But I have to eat them. Right? Now be nice. But, you know, sometimes we just have to do things because that's the way they have to be done. And then all of a sudden, what? Your choices become new habits and you start feeling better because of them. It can be the same way with generosity. Start doing things because you know they are the right things to do. And eventually joy will become part of the experience too. What's something else we can learn about true generosity through verse 7? True generosity gets noticed by your Heavenly Father. True generosity gets noticed by your Heavenly Father. For God loves a cheerful giver. Amen. Ain't that cool? God loves a cheerful giver. God sees when you give. He notices your generosity. In Matthew 6, verses 2 to 4, Jesus talks about that very thing. So Jesus says, when you give to the poor, do not sound a trumpet before you, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and on the streets, so they will be praised by people. Truly, I say to you, they have their reward in full. But when you give to the poor, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your charitable giving will be in secret. Now, here it is. Here it is. And your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. Isn't that cool? True generosity gets noticed by your Heavenly Father. And also from this section in 2 Corinthians 9, verse 7, true generosity can be fun.
Amen.
It's true. God loves a cheerful giver.
Hilarious.
Ah. Yeah, some of you actually remember what I preached from back a number of weeks ago. This is cool. Cool. Yeah, the Greek word is hilaros, from which we get our word hilarious. God loves a hilarious giver. Pastor and generosity speaker Brian Cluth once said, some people say, give until it hurts. But God recommends that we give until it feels good. God loves a cheerful giver. Hey, we're digging up gold here, folks. True generosity always gets a return. True generosity is proportional and conditional. True generosity comes from a freed heart. True generosity gets noticed by your Heavenly Father. True generosity can be fun. What's next in the things we learn about true generosity from verses 8 to 11? Well, true generosity gets rewarded by your Heavenly Father. And God is... Sorry, I'm going to move too fast here if I don't be careful. It gets rewarded by my Heavenly Father. God is able to make all grace overflow to you. And in verse 11, you will be enriched in everything.
Amen.
And what was it we read in Matthew? Your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. You see, true generosity gets rewarded by your Heavenly Father. What other gold nugget can we dig up about true generosity, verses 8 and 11? Well, true generosity gets multiplied. It gets multiplied. And God is able to make all grace overflow to you so that always, having all sufficiency in everything, you may sit back and relax like a fat cat. Is that what it says? I'm sorry. Is that what it said? Where are we? Where's that next verse? Oh, I'm sorry. I know I'm going fast. I need that next verse. Where is it? All grace abound to you, so that always having all sufficiency and everything, you may sit back like a fat cat. No, it doesn't say that, does it? No. So that you may have an abundance for every good deed. Generosity gets multiplied so that you can be even more generous. Isn't that cool? And Paul repeats the idea in verse 11, just in case we missed it. You will be enriched in everything for all liberality. Another translation, which I believe you have up there, says you will be enriched in every way so that you can be generous on every occasion. Wow. In every way. Not just financially, but physically, emotionally, spiritually, in every way to be generous on every occasion. It's not just about giving to get and then hoarding it all. You see, God made you to be a river, not a reservoir. Do we have that picture up here? The next screen. Anybody know what that's a little map of?
Israel.
So what's that circle at the top? Sea of Galilee. What's this down the bottom? Why is it called the Dead Sea? Water flows in, but never flows out. If you want to, in your little notes beside God made you to be a river, not a reservoir, draw a little picture of this thing right here. Just draw that right in there. Just do a little doodling. That's the idea. The Sea of Galilee has an inflow and an outflow. The Dead Sea is dead because there's nothing flowing out. It's only going in. God wants you to be a river, not a reservoir. Oh, two more gold nuggets that we can find out about true generosity. Verse 10. True generosity enriches my spirit. Verse 10. Am I going slow enough now? Okay. Now he who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and, here it is, increase the harvest of what? Your righteousness. Isn't that cool? Your act of generosity increases the harvest of righteousness. That's cool. This is an eternal spiritual principle here, folks. Righteousness, the will and ability to do what pleases God and live in right relationship with Him and everyone else around you. You see, God wants to increase the harvest of your righteousness. And one way He does that is through generosity, helping you to learn generosity and living a giving life. And finally, verse 11, true generosity blesses God. True generosity blesses God. You will be enriched in everything for all liberality which through us is producing thanksgiving to God. See, God gets blessed by your generosity. God gets blessed by the recipients of your generosity as they thank Him. Now, there's a maybe something you can connect here. If you're being generous, and if you do that anonymously, do it anonymously. Absolutely. God may have you do that once in a while, and that's okay. Hopefully that person will end up thanking and blessing God for the gift of whatever it was that you were able to do. But if your generosity is sort of face-to-face, up front, and somebody says, why are you doing this? Don't back down from why. Tell them, you know what? God has blessed me and He wants me to bless you. Just tell them. Tell them what it means to you. Yes. And hopefully, even if they're not a believer, they will still go, oh, well, okay. Yeah, their God did so. Yeah, God still can get blessed out of that. Be open about why you're doing what you're doing. Let them know why you do it. The other side of things, God also gets blessed as generosity produces thanksgiving to Him in your heart because you see the results of it, the positive impact it maybe had in somebody's life. And the sense of your well-being is increased and you go, oh, thank you, God, for that opportunity. Thank you, God. We can bless God. Oh, there's lots of gold to be discovered in God's Word. And there's a way that we can keep moving forward in all of this. And I trust that as you put these into practice, you'll discover everything God has for you. Let's pray. Father, thank You that You were generous to us through Your Son, Jesus Christ. That He was willing to die on the cross, as our sister Sharon sang this morning and helped us to focus on His generosity to us. Dying for me, that last line said in that chorus. Wow. Thank You, Jesus. May we be more and more conformed to Your image, to the image that brings meaning and purpose and hope to every single aspect of our lives, especially in this area of giving, living. Thank You, Jesus. Amen. Amen. I couldn't think of a better song to end with than this old hymn that I would love for you, if you're able to stand and sing together with me, Higher Ground. I'm pressing on the upward way. Let's press on to the goal.
I'm pressing on the upward way, new heights I'm gaining every day, as many as I'm upward bound. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith in heaven's tableland, a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. My heart has no desire to stay.
faith on heaven's table and a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to live above the world, though Satan's darts at me are hurled. For faith has caught the joyful sound, the song of saints on higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table and a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. I want to scale the utmost height and catch a gleam of glory bright, but still I'll pray till heaven I've found. Lord, lead me on to higher ground. Lord, lift me up and let me stand by faith on heaven's table and a higher plane than I have found. Lord, plant my feet on high.
Highest ground is to love God, hey, and to love each other, and then go out there and be the church in ways that are generous, all kinds of ways. God bless you as you go.